Imagine the world is represented by these bubbles. If we resize them according to the population size, we get this picture. I'm going to rank them from poorest to richest and show you how people live around the world. We'll start with farmers living with less than $2 per day and climb all the way to Elon Musk. And I'm gonna make a bet. You probably can't answer these two simple questions about the world. Fewer than 2% of my viewers got them right. Question 1. Where does the majority of the world population live? A. Low income, B. Middle income, or C. High income countries? And 2. Since year 2000, has global wealth inequality A. increased, B. stayed the same, or C. decreased? Hold on to your answers, we'll come back to them. This video was inspired by the book Factfulness, and I also took inspiration from these videos. I'm gonna rank our countries starting at the bottom. According to the World Bank, the 10 countries with the lowest GDP per capita in the world are all African countries. The more the bubbles are to the left, the lower the GDP per capita. And the country with the lowest GDP per capita is Burundi. Let's see how people live there. The median wage in Burundi is $1.80 per day. Each woman has an average of around 5 children. Child mortality is high, and 5% of children don't make it to 5 years old. Families are large, and most of them depend on agriculture to make a living. Most people live in rural areas, often in houses made with mud bricks. The Gapminder Foundation documented how families live around the world and made their footage freely available. This family with 1 woman and 4 children had a total income of 90 cents per day. They live in a house with no electricity. Light comes from fire, which they also use to cook. This family sleeps on a bed made of straw, and this is their toilet. To find water, they need to walk to natural sources and carry that water back home. Most families in Burundi live in extreme poverty, and that's also true for most people in these countries. But so far, our chart only includes about 3.6% of the world population. I'm going to keep adding more countries until we get to about a quarter of the population. We get mostly African countries like Ethiopia and Nigeria, and Asian countries like Pakistan and Bangladesh. I'm going to pick Bangladesh and see how people live there. The median income in Bangladesh is $4.78 per day. Each woman has an average of 2.3 children. This family has 5 people, and they live in a house with a metal roof. They have beds, they have access to a pipe well, which is how most people get their water in Bangladesh, they have a toilet and a place to wash their hands. They also have basic phones. Their house has electricity, like more than 99% of households in Bangladesh. This might not sound like a big deal, but in Portugal, a high-income country in the country where I'm from, if we go back to 1970, only 64% of the population had access to electricity. Some people think that countries like Bangladesh will always stay poor, but the reality is that Bangladesh, in some aspects, is already more developed than the Portugal my parents grew up in. If we go back to our bubbles and add colors based on the income level according to the World Bank, we see that even though we're at the bottom 23% of the population, most countries in this chart are not considered low income. Bangladesh is considered medium income, or lower middle income to be precise. Most of the world population lives in middle income countries. A question that only 27% of my audience got right. I also got it wrong. In 2000, 29% of people lived in extreme poverty. Nowadays, that percentage has fallen to less than a third. In a single generation, billions transitioned out of poverty. And while that was happening, another quiet transformation took place. Millions of people transitioned out of their poor problem-solving skills with Brilliant, the sponsor of this video. Brilliant is a platform for learning math, computer science, data analysis, and AI that helps you get smarter every day. The thing about Brilliant is that you learn with interactive examples. So you don't learn by memorizing lectures, you learn by doing, which is a more effective way to learn. Brilliant works on your phone, so instead of wasting your commute scrolling on social media, you can replace that with a bit of learning every day and make a new habit out of it. There's thousands of interactive lessons to choose from. It doesn't matter if you're a total beginner or more advanced, there's content for every level. You can try this course to get started with Python, or this course to learn data analysis. It includes problems with real datasets from sources like Airbnb. You can scan the QR code on screen or visit brilliant.org/memeabledata to get a 30-day free trial, and you also get 20% off Brilliant's annual premium subscription. Let's keep adding countries until we reach half of the world's population. We now see India and other countries across Asia, Africa, and Latin America. Let's see how people live in Indonesia. The median wage is around $6 per day, and women have on average around 2 children. Most families now live in urban areas, not rural. As countries develop, the population tends to migrate from the countryside into urban areas. This family of 4 lives in a house with a bathroom, a kitchen, bedrooms, and other amenities we didn't see in the previous income levels. Motorbikes are a common means of transportation, and most people have access to internet and use smartphones. We're entering the richer half of the world. We now get mostly upper-middle-income countries from Latin America, Eastern Europe, Africa, and Asia, including China. Let's pick Brazil. The median wage in Brazil is about $13 per day. And in Brazil, women have on average 1.6 children. For the first time, we get a fertility rate below the replacement level. Wealthier countries tend to have lower fertility rates. Although hunger is still a problem in Brazil, more people die from obesity than undernutrition. As countries develop, the percentage of obese population also tends to increase. At this level of income, it's now common for people to have a car and a computer. Brazil is above the global average, but still far from the world's richest. If we add more bubbles, we start getting high-income countries. We're now at 90% of the world's population, and I'm gonna pick Spain. The median income is $41 per day. In countries like Spain, most people live in good quality housing. They have access to decent healthcare, social security, and public facilities. At this tier, you also start getting the freedom to travel to almost everywhere. A Spanish citizen can travel to a total of 189 countries visit-free. For most of the world, that is not the case. If we look at the passport index of every country, we see that lower-income countries have a lower number of destinations they can visit without a visa. The freedom to travel the world depends on the income level of your country. Despite having good living standards compared to the rest of the world, many people in these countries haven't enjoyed the economic growth we got in countries like Bangladesh or Indonesia. I spoke with economist Branko Milanovic, one of the researchers behind the famous chart explaining this. It's called the elephant curve. On the x-axis, we have the income percentile of the global population. The chart shows us how much income has grown across the population in the 20 years up to 2008. The people around the 50th percentile of income, mostly people in Asia, saw big gains. But then for the Western middle class, the curve flatlines.
People who are around the 75th, 80th percentile of the world income distribution, which means they are richer than the Chinese, had very slow growth, and in many cases actually growth of close to 0% per year over 20 years.
And meanwhile, the global top 1% captured a large share of the growth, riding the wave of globalization. In recent years, the curve becomes smoother, but the pattern still holds. Many in the West feel stuck, while much of Asia has moved up. Let's move higher. In the final 10% of the world's population, we find the wealthiest countries such as the US. The median wage in the US is about $62 per day. Living standards are not super different from the previous tier, but people can afford more things here. Americans tend to have bigger houses, bigger cars, and they can buy more things in general. Most Americans are quite rich compared to the rest of the world.
It is 11 to 12% of Americans who are in the global top 1%. And I think many of them don't realize that.
But this doesn't mean every American is rich. So far, we've only been looking at country averages. But inside each of these bubbles, there are both rich people and poor people. We need to look at the inequality within countries. The bubbles now show how much income the top 10% earn in each country. In the US, the top 10% get 47% of the income. The country with the highest income inequality is South Africa, where the top 10% get 65% of the income. And we're talking about income, which tells you how much money someone earns. But we should also look at the wealth, the accumulated worth of everything you own. It includes your savings, but also your house, your car, and your investments, making it arguably a better indicator of inequality. If we switch the chart from income to wealth inequality, the gap becomes even bigger. South Africa also has the highest wealth inequality, with the top 10% holding almost 86% of the total wealth. On the other hand, in the Netherlands, they own 45%. Wealth inequality within countries has generally increased in the last decades. Each country has a different trend, but in the US, the top 10% owns 71% of the wealth in 2021, more than 25 years earlier. This number also went up in all of the world's top 10 economies. This can have negative impacts, and several economists argue that the more unequal a society, the weaker its institutions tend to become over time. The World Inequality Report argues that this was not inevitable, but a political choice. They argue that in the 80s, leaders like Ronald Reagan and Margaret Thatcher pushed a series of policies that made private wealth go up and public wealth go down. So their argument here is that if governments own less, then in theory they're less capable of tackling inequality. But from now on, we're not going to talk about countries anymore. We're entering global wealth tiers. If your wealth is at least $1 million, then you're part of the global 1%. This could mean having $1 million in your bank account or just owning an expensive house. There are 82 million people in this group, and they own 38% of the world's wealth. To make it to the top 0.01%, you need a wealth of at least $21 million. There are about 800,000 people in this group, and they own 11% of the world's wealth. It's estimated that private jets are used by about 0.003% of the population, which would be about 30% of this group. If your wealth is at least $1 billion, then you're considered a billionaire. There are roughly 3,000 billionaires in the world, and they own 3% of the world's wealth. Over the years, the wealth of global billionaires has gone up, and the same is true for the people in the previous tier. But one billionaire takes the number one position on Forbes. As of the making of this video, Elon Musk is the wealthiest person in the world with a net worth of almost $400 billion. Between 2020 and 2024, Elon Musk's wealth grew at an average rate of $1,300 per second. If Elon Musk saw a $100 bill on the floor, it would literally not be worth his time to pick it up. So now that we've reached the top, let's revisit question two. Has global inequality gone up since 2000? Most of my audience said yes, and that makes sense. We've seen the rise of billionaires in the top 0.01% and increasing inequality within countries. But the answer, to my own surprise, is C. Global inequality has actually gone down. But how's that possible?
To be very sort of blunt, a reducing inequality between Malawi and the UK is much more important than reducing inequality within the UK.
Although inequality within countries went up in many regions, the inequality between countries has gone down. The global top 10% now owns 74% of the wealth, which is less than before. And the bottom 50% own 2.1% of the wealth, which is not much, but still higher than in 2000. Developing countries are catching up. If we go back to 1990, the bubble chart looked like this. Almost 40% of the world lived in low-income countries. As the years passed, billions climbed out of poverty, and now most of the world lives in middle-income countries. This doesn't mean that people aren't struggling or that we shouldn't worry about rising inequality within countries, but personally, I also think it's important that we acknowledge the progress that has been made. Most people, myself included, fail these questions because we don't have an accurate picture of the world. That's the video for today, thank you for watching. This one took a bit longer with all the data animations. If you were able to get both questions of the survey correct without reading the book Factfulness, I'm curious about how you did it. If you like stories told with data, consider subscribing to the channel, and thank you to our patrons.